Good morning. Welcome to Greenville United Methodist Church. Just a couple of announcements this morning. This is a big week for our children's ministry. This is Vacation Bible School Week, and they'll have a lot going on. If you'd like to volunteer for that, please see Lauren. I know they will need help probably decorating on the 11th. But if you know of any kids in our community, please let them know. It'll be Friday, Saturday, and Sunday this year. So let's invite the kids here and fill the place up. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Greenville United Methodist Church. I am, again, not Pastor Stephen Neel. He is still on vacation, even though he's sitting right here in the front row. In the words of Dorothy, there's no place like home. And so sometimes the best vacation, especially if you ask me, is just being at home without any interruptions. And so we're happy that he's here this morning. And we just are glad that he's able to take some time off and to spend some time with family. We just ask that you would stand with us this morning as we sing our opening song of worship. Time that we come to the altar in prayer. I do want to mention that, in case you haven't heard, Mary Jane Gibbons' brother passed away Friday. And so remember their family in prayer. We have a special prayer this morning, and so we're going to have the Lovell family come down, and then I'm just going to turn prayer time over to Pastor Steve.
Peace of God be with you. This time is always knowing from the Word of God, it offers these words in the book of James. If there are any among you that are sick, they should call for the elders of the church, and the elders should pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of our Lord. Prayer that comes from faith will heal the sick, for the Lord will restore them to health. The Word of God for the people of God. I'd ask them if they would kneel, and we would encourage you that are here today that you can come and lay your hands upon them or someone near, that we will offer prayer.
A lot of people say you don't have to come to church to be a Christian, and that is fact. But this is part of the reason you need to come to church, is so that when you're facing trials and tribulations in your life, your family that maybe you weren't born into but God gifted you into can circle around you and pray for you and encourage you and uplift you. And so I just thank God for my church family this morning. Can we stand and worship together the song Victory in Jesus?
Thank you. Let us pray. Lord God, we just thank you for this day. Lord, we just ask your blessings upon everyone that's come out today. We just ask for your presence to fall on this place. And Lord, bless these tithes and offerings and use them to build thy kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
So long ago make such a difference in this world that I know. When I heard the story of God's only Son, in that moment I felt like my life had finally begun. The unchanging story is always the same. Every time I hear it, feel my heart change. Now open a Bible that is tattered and worn. You'll still find a message with the power to transform. Takes a heart that is so hard and moves it to tears. Takes a life that is so scarred and wipes away all the fears. The unchanging story my heart changed. Yesterday and forever, it always will be. The unchanging story that's still changing me. Doubters may tell darkness assail you and try to deceive, but nothing can stop a child on his knees lifting his voice crying, Lord, I believe the unchanging story is always the same. Every time I hear it, I feel my heart change. Yesterday and forever,
First of all, I want you all to meet my friend Kevin Campbell. Kevin is from the Hanson Methodist Church, and as soon as he gets done singing for special music, he's going to have to buck out because he's the lay leader over there, but he was kind enough to come and sing for us this morning. So after special music, his next song. And isn't he a wonderful singer? Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I have something to show you. Let me get her pulled up here. Everybody look. Can you see she's still on there? Isn't she cute? She looks, I wish you all could see her. This is my oldest granddog. And my oldest granddog's name is Harmony. You know, like music, melody, and harmony. Yeah, I know. Well, you'll learn it someday when you get to school. Anyway, so Harmony sometimes doesn't know what she wants to do. Okay? And this children's moment is about making decisions. Y'all ever have to make decisions? Yeah, it's kind of tough sometimes, isn't it? But you know, in Harmony's case, she doesn't really care. This morning when she got up, she was in bed with me and she was in her little cage there. And I opened the door. Well, she jumped out of her cage and she looks at me and she looks at my dog. And then she looks around the room and then she jumps off the bed. And then she jumps to the door and then she comes back. And then she looks at me like, aren't you going to open the door? And then she runs out and then she runs into the living room where the other granddog was. Yes, let's not go there. Okay, so then she runs into the house and she sees, okay, somebody's got to do something. I don't know what I got to do. Okay, then she runs to the window and she looks out the window to see if somebody's out there. And if somebody's out there, she's going to bark at them. And if she's not out there, then she'd say, okay, I'm done with this. And then she'll run over here and then she'll do this. And she'll say, okay, somebody take me outside. Then she goes outside and she does what she's supposed to do outside. And then she sees a bird. Then she chases the bird. Her decisions are made upon just that really, really quick point. Let's do it like that. But you know, it's not like that for us as humans, is it? It's not like that for us. How many times do you all go out to eat after church today? If you go out to eat, your mom or dad might say, okay, where are we going to eat today? And what's the first thing we usually say? I don't know. What are you in the mood for? I don't know. When you got up this morning, when you all got up this morning, when I got up this morning, what was I going to wear? I don't know. I knew I wanted to wear my gray slacks, but I thought, okay, what do I want to wear with it? Do I want to wear a plain shirt, a white shirt? I had to make a decision. You know, the neat thing about God is that He allows us to make a decision about whether we want to be a Christian or not. And as Miss Rochelle's going to preach for you this morning, the title of her sermon is, you got to love somebody and you got to serve somebody. And you know, when me and my wife had kids and they started coming along, you know, we said, we're going to take you to church. We're going to raise you in church. We're going to let the church, as they talked about a while ago, love you and raise you. And that's what they're doing for you. So you're going to hear from Ms. Rochelle, hey, you got to serve somebody. And we're going to serve God because God told us to do that. As for me and my house, we're going to serve God. Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. And thank you for giving us the ability to make decisions. And thank you for helping us to make the decision for you. And to serve you and to go out and share your light with everybody. We ask this in your name. Amen. Okay, thank you guys. Good.
As they are picking out their suckers, I ask that you stand and worship with me, singing, How Great is Our God.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our
after testimony how great our God truly is. And so Kevin is going to sing again. That's not in my bulletin, so. So Kevin, please come up and worship our great God with us.
Now I truly do feel at home. I am really used to being forgotten. I'll just tell you a little story on our former district superintendent, William Moore. When he was our pastor at Hanson, when I would sing, more often than not, he would forget me, even though he had a bulletin in front of him. And it became funny because some point during the service, he would make eye contact with me, and then it would click, like, oh no, I've done it again. So I'm used to it.
It was storms of my life. That's where God proves His love to me.
Joshua 24, starting at verse 14. And I'm going to ask that you stand if you're able for the reading of God's holy word. So fear the Lord and serve Him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols of your ancestors and what they worshipped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt. Serve the Lord alone. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates, or it will be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live? But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Thank you. So I'm a music lover. I love all kinds of music. I don't really discriminate. I'm not really big into like heavy metal, but I can listen to pop and country and rap and R&B and folk and just a wide range of music. I really just like music. And so you can ask my girls, because a lot of times they want to get in the car and change my radio station. For the most part, I listen to The Message, which is a contemporary Christian station, and it is my favorite because I like to fuel my soul with good things. And I struggle enough with the battle in my mind that I need the good things fed into it. But the other day I decided to indulge into some secular music. And I heard a song from Bob Dylan that I'd never heard before. And so I want to read you, I won't sing it and I won't play it for you, but I want to read you the lyrics of that song. You may have heard it, you may not have heard it. It says, you may be an ambassador to England or France. You might like to gamble or you might like to dance. You might be a heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls. You might be a rock and roll addict prancing on stage. You might have the drugs at your command or women in a cage. You may be a businessman or some high degree thief. They may call you doctor, they may call you chief. You may be a state trooper, or you might be a young Turk. You may be the head of some big TV network. You might be rich, or you might be blind and lame. You may be living in another country or under another name. You may be a construction worker working on a home. You may be living in a mansion, or you might live in a dome. You might own guns, and you might even own tanks. You might be somebody's landlord, or you might even own banks. You might be a preacher with some spiritual pride. You may be a city councilman taking bribes on the side. You may be working in a barbershop. You may know how to cut hair. You might be somebody's mistress, or you might be somebody's heir. You might like to wear cotton. You might like to wear silk. You might drink heavy whiskey. You might like to drink milk. You might like to eat caviar. You might like to eat bread. You may be sleeping on the floor or sleeping in a king-size bed. But you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. And as I listened to that song that I had never heard before, I thought, wow, Bob Dylan, that's a pretty good message. Doesn't matter what you are, who you are, what you have, what you don't have, what you like, what you don't like, what secrets you may be hiding, what things may be out in the open, you every day have to make the choice to serve somebody. And so that became my inspiration for the message this morning. And I could leave it there and I could dismiss and you guys could get an early lunch, but I'm not going to do that. So going back to our scripture in Joshua, a little bit of history of that. Joshua had been under the command of Moses as the Israelites wandered in the wilderness. They had been in slavery in Egypt for 400 years, and God had delivered them from that slavery. And they'd been wandering around the desert for 40 years until they finally were able to settle into the promised land. So Joshua has gathered them together because Joshua knows that, he's lived in the desert with them for 40 years, so he's kind of gotten to know these people. And he's kind of known that as humans, especially these set of humans, they're most vulnerable when things are going good. You know, they want to cry out to God for help when they were in slavery, but when things were kind of going better in the desert, they wanted to grumble and complain because it wasn't what they wanted. It wasn't the promised land. But God was still providing for them and God was still doing for them. So Joshua knew that this particular set of humans, and we alike, become most vulnerable when things are going good. That's kind of when we start to let our guard down, and that's kind of when we stop crying out to the Lord for help because we don't really need anything at the time. And so Joshua knew that. And so he's calling the people together and saying, you know, you can serve the past gods that you served when you were slaves in Egypt, or you can serve the one true God, or you can serve the new gods in the land that you're now living in. But you're going to have to make a choice, and he wants to bring that to their attention before they get too set in and settled. They had a long history of just serving gods of convenience, like, or what kind of fit the problem at the time, like we kind of do with our shoes. If we're going running, we put on running shoes. If we're going hiking, we put on hiking shoes. If we're going to church, some of us women may put on heels. Whatever the situation is, we kind of change our shoes for that. And that's kind of what they had been accustomed doing with their gods. If there was a family problem, then they would pray to the God of relationships. If there was a problem with the crops, then they would pray to the crop God. If there was a problem with infertility, they would pray to the fertility God. Whatever the present crisis was, or whatever it was that they were in need, that was the God that they were going to choose to serve in that moment. So it was more of what's going to fit my desires right now, and that's the God that I'm going to serve. So Joshua was now asking them to select, to choose the one true God who had delivered them out of the hands of their enemies in Egypt, guided them through the wilderness, and then brought them into the promised land. Not the most convenient God, but the one true God. He was asking them to choose the God that had delivered them, guided them, protected them, provided for them, and conquered other nations for them. Joshua is calling them to be faithful in their obedience to the one true God. He wants them to understand that there is a difference between the concept of gods and the God. God is a holy and jealous God. He is not a God that can be bribed. He is not a God that will wait around for while the Israelites flirt with other gods. And he is not a God that governs one small part of the world while others claim their part. He is the one and only God, the God with all the power, the God who loves so much that he was constantly not just redeeming them, just as he can constantly redeems us today through the power of Jesus Christ, but he's a God who was constantly seeking their love and devotion in return and is still constantly seeking our love and devotion in return. And so Joshua questions the people, whom will you serve? It should have been an easy question to answer. It should be an easy question for us to answer today. The people of Israel had come to a time of peace and rest, and they were in a ready-made paradise, the promised land. It was a land described as flowing with milk and honey, and it was just, you know, it was just so much better than Egypt, where they had been set free from, and Israel, or the wilderness, where they had been wandering around for 40 years. Yet Joshua knew that they could and would get comfortable and forget. You know, he had spent that 40 years with them in the wilderness. He knew how quickly they would get comfortable and forget the things that God had done for them. They had done that with the manna. You know, they were starving and they were hungry and hungry and hungry, and please, Lord, feed us. And so God gave them manna from heaven, and they had just like free food every morning. But they quickly got comfortable with that and began to grumble and complain about it because they'd forgot their time of being hungry, and that now that they were being provided for. So Joshua just knew, you know, hey, take a moment and make a conscious choice. Who are you going to serve? We're no different today. If we're going through a bad time, if someone has cancer, if someone, you know, is facing something, if we've got an uphill battle to climb, we're going to cry out for God. We need God. We need God. We need God. But when things are going good, we tend to forget about that God that we need, and we start to kind of drift backwards instead of progressing forward in our relationship with Him. We often claim to be wholeheartedly devoted to God, true followers of Christ, yet we are often distracted by the first thing that comes along and tempts us. We find ourselves trying to worship God and the things of this world. Oftentimes we even try to worship ourselves. We don't realize that we're worshiping ourselves, but we are worshiping ourselves because we're seeking it to what makes us happy. This isn't going to make me happy, so I don't want to do it. And so it becomes all about me and that self-worship. We tend to try to lean on our own strength, go our own direction, and be our own gods. There's 4 points that I want you to take with you today. The first is that you can't have it all. You cannot serve the Lord and seek the things of this earth at the same time. Every day, you have to get up and make a conscious choice. Salvation is not just a one-time decision. It is an everyday, minute-by-minute, moment-by-moment decision. Am I going to serve the Lord, or am I going to do what pleases myself? You cannot serve the Lord and the world at the same time. The second point I want you to take is that there are many things that become like gods to us. In this world of just modernness and materialistic things, there are so many things that become God to us. Money, relationships, women, men, children. We oftentimes, you know, find our happiness in our children and our grandchildren. And when we no longer have our grandchildren or our children around, we feel very void and very empty. I know I'm kind of going through that a little bit right now because we're experiencing a little bit empty nesting. And sometimes there's a little void, but I've got to realize that my happiness doesn't come from my children. They are not my God. My happiness, my joy comes from the Lord. We can worship our parents, leaders of the world, our jobs, drugs, alcohol, the willingness to and the desire to be successful, cars, our phones. A lot of times we're seeing less and less of people flipping through this and more people flipping through this. How much time are you spending in this compared to how much time you're doing this? You know, our phones have kind of become God. TV shows, you know, how much time are you spending watching television versus being in the Word or spending time in prayer and in communication with God? Food has become, and I'm just as guilty as the next with food. Food, I love me some food, and sometimes I think about food more than I think about God. And so there's just so many things out there that can become like gods to us. And so we have to be really careful. Are we serving the one true God, or are we serving the little materialistic things of this earth that bring us temporary happiness, not even full joy? The third thing I want you to take is that you must choose. You can serve God, you can serve yourself, or you can serve the world, but you can't serve them all. We can choose to follow His word or the philosophies of men, but we cannot do both. We can choose to worship the Spirit of truth, or we can choose the worship that pleases us, but we cannot do both. The important thing about that I like is that there's truth, there's what's in here, without a shadow of a doubt. God lays it out for us. But a lot of times we like to listen to the philosophies of men because it fits our desires better. It doesn't step on our toes the way that this does. And we can't do both. We can't live for what the world says is right and ignore what God says is right. That's trying to have it both ways. And so we cannot do that. You have to make a choice. We can choose a lifestyle of holiness or a lifestyle of the world, but we can't do both. And what I want you to remember is that choosing not to serve God, if you've not made that choice to have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, maybe you're putting it off, or maybe you're just not buying into it yet, or it's like, it's not that I don't believe in God, but I'm just not ready to commit to God yet. Not choosing to serve God is still making a choice, and it's choosing to not serve Him. And so remember that. We often can acknowledge the right choice, but we still don't make it. The fourth thing that I want you to take is that all choices come with consequences. Good or bad, your choices come with consequences. Rejection of God can bring harsh consequences, but choosing God can bring blessings. I think Moses called them blessings and curses. But all of our choices have a consequence. And so it's time to make a choice. Joshua's question to the Israelites is still as valid today as it was to them. We are still the same type of people that get comfortable in our salvation and in our relationship with Christ. And we forget about daily choosing to serve Him, and we start putting things of this world before Him. There's a lack of conviction among people who confess to be Christians, and I'm just as guilty of that. We all face times where we're torn between serving the Lord and living for things of this world. We need to make our minds up. Do we want to be a Christian or do we not? And so I got to thinking about, what if somebody followed me around from my day-to-day life? And so pose this question to yourself. If I was truly 100% myself at all times while somebody was watching me, and they followed me around from my day-to-day life, would it be evident to them that in every moment of my life that I was choosing to serve the Lord? Would they be able to tell that I was wholeheartedly sold out for Jesus Christ because I was in everything that I do choosing to serve the Lord? Honestly, I can say is that no, in every moment of my life, there are times where I question, am I serving the Lord or am I serving the world? And I let the world come between me and my relationship with God. And so, you know, ask yourself, if someone followed you around and watched you and everything that you said and everything that you did, would they be able to tell that in everything that you did, you were making a conscious choice to serve the Lord? So I leave you with the same question today that Joshua said. I guess it's more of a proclamation. Choose today who you're going to serve. And then make that choice every day for the rest of your life, every moment for the rest of your life. Because there are moments where it's just so easily for us to get distracted. And in that moment, we have to choose, am I going to serve the Lord or am I going to not serve the Lord in that moment? Because Christianity, it's just like love. Love is a choice. Building your relationship with Jesus Christ is a choice. And you have to make that choice day by day, moment by moment, building that relationship, strengthening that firm foundation, and then showing that to the world. And so in the words of Bob Dylan, you do gotta serve somebody. Who are you serving? And so as we close this morning, I want you to think about, are you serving the Lord in every aspect of your life? Maybe you've never made the choice at all to serve the Lord, and today's the day that you want to make that choice. Or maybe you've noticed that you're serving the world a little bit more than you're serving Christ, and you want to restore that brokenness that sin has brought between you and Christ. I want to offer you the opportunity to come and kneel before the throne now and just confess those things to Him and seek His forgiveness and start anew with making that daily choice to serve the Lord. Thank you. As you go about your week, be sure that you're making a conscious effort to choose to serve the Lord so that others may see His light and His love in you. Go and have a great week. Thank you.